Morning. Can I welcome everyone to the Justice Committee's 15th meeting of 2015 and ask everyone to switch off mobile phones and other electronic devices as they interfere with broadcasting, even when they're switched to silent. No apologies in received, and I welcome Patricia Ferguson to the committee, who of course has an interest because of her own member's bill. Item 1 on the agenda is consideration of affirmative instrument, the Draft Proceeds of Crime Act 2002, Cash Searches, Constables in Scotland Code of Practice Order 2015. Welcome to meeting Michael Matheson, Cabinet Secretary for Justice, and the Scottish Government officials, Leanne Barclay, Policy Officer at the Organised Crime and Policy Powers Unit, and Carla McCloy-Stevens, Solicitor, Legal Directorate. And Cabinet Secretary, I know you're giving evidence in advance of the debate in the instrument, and I believe you want to make a brief opening statement.
Yes, thank you. Thank you, Convener, and good morning. I'm grateful for the opportunity to speak to you about the Draft Proceeds of Crime Act 2002, Order 2015. It proposes to bring into operation a revised code of practice in connection with the exercise by constables in Scotland of the powers conferred by Section 289 of the Proceeds of Crime Act 2002. Section 289 of the Proceeds of Crime Act allows constables to search individuals and premises for cash which is recoverable property or is intended for use in unlawful conduct and which is not less than the minimum amount, which is currently £1,000. It forms part of a suite of measures which provide for the search, seizure and forfeiture of such cash. The search powers are subject to certain limits and conditions and generally require the prior approval of a sheriff. As a further safeguard, Section 293 of the Proceeds of Crime Act requires Scottish ministers to provide a code of practice for constables in Scotland to ensure that they exercise these search powers in an appropriate, fair and proportionate way. The code has been in operation for over 12 years and was last revised in 2009. The current revision comes as a result of amendments made to Section 289 of the Proceeds of Crime Act by Section 63 of the Policing and Crime Act 2009. These are due to come into force on the 1st of June 2015. They insert new provisions into Section 289 of the Proceeds of Crime Act, which enable constables to search vehicles for cash in certain circumstances. Currently, a constable may search a vehicle under Section 289 of the Proceeds of Crime Act if it's located on premises which are already the subject of a search and the constable has lawful authority to be there. The new power, however, allows a constable to search a vehicle where it appears to be under the control of an identifiable person and is in a public place. If the constable has reasonable grounds to suspect that there is recoverable cash in the vehicle, he or she may require the person to permit entry to and search of the vehicle. The new powers may be used where a vehicle is within environs of a dwelling, but only if the constable has reasonable grounds for believing that the person in control of the vehicle does not reside in the dwelling and that the vehicle is there without the permission of a person who does reside there. Accordingly, the current revision of the code simply applies the existing guidance and standards of practice to the new powers for searches of vehicles. And of course, I'm happy to answer any questions members may have.
Thank you very much. Questions, John Finney.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary, if I noted you correctly, you said that generally require the authorisation of a sheriff. When are the instances when a sheriff's authorisation wouldn't be required?
Well, there would be circumstances where it may be impractical because of the immediacy of the situation, where a constable may be able to undertake the search. Now, in those circumstances where they're not able to get authorisation from a sheriff, they should seek authorisation from a senior officer of the rank of inspector or above to proceed with such a search. If there are circumstances where that isn't possible, then they can conduct the search, but there's a process that they then must go through, which is for the reporting of that, the details of that, and an explanation as to why and what the outcome of it was, but why it was undertaken without the normal authorisation process. and there's an oversight process for that as well. So for those cases where that approach has been taken, the appropriate person that the legislation provides for is able to consider these matters and to look at whether they have exercised their powers under the code of practice appropriately as well. So there's an oversight mechanism for that as well to check it.
Excuse me, and what would the avenue of redress be in the circumstances where they hadn't been properly exercised?
That would then be for the appropriate person who would consider how it had been utilised, how they'd undertaken that particular search, and to then consider referring the matter to the Chief Constable of the force that they are that they were serving with, to look at the process and to make sure that it had been properly adhered to. If there was any other legal challenges for that, then that would obviously be a matter for the courts to consider.
I mean, I understand that, that there's practice for this already, but people would imagine, if we're talking about proceeds of crime, that to even have it in that category, there's been some pre-planning, if you like, and searches are always better undertaken under warrant rather than, if you like, on a discretionary basis.
The reality is the vast majority of the searches which are undertaken under proceeds of crime are intelligence-based searches where authorisation has been given by a sheriff in the form of a warrant. So that tends to be the practical reality of it in the first place. There will, of course, be the exceptions, and that's why the Code of Practice has these arrangements and also why the legislation has a provision for the appropriate person who's got an oversight role in how they're being applied as well.
Okay, thank you very much.
It's not just the proceeds of crime, is it? It's also deemed to be suspected for reasonable grounds for the purposes of crime.
No, this is for the purposes, this Code of Practice for the purposes of the Proceeds of Crime Act.
Just proceeds, not
only
for
the Proceeds of Crime Act.
I'm just checking that. We have policy objective or is intended by any person for use in unlawful conduct, which is not necessarily the minimum amount, so intended for use, any person for use in unlawful conduct. That's certainly what we've got as our policy.
This is guidance. For the purposes of if you're exercising that under the Proceeds of Crime Act.
Uh-huh.
Not for any other area, any other...
No, I understand, but it's not just recoverable property which have come from crime, but it's cash which might be
could
used,
be used for
after,
the purposes,
for the purposes
of,
yes. of crime. That's just yes. to clarify that, but... It's early for me, but I think I've worked that out. Rod?
Morning. The revised code of practice, it says here it's available for consultation by the police and by members of the public if they so wish. Are you able to provide any information on how far the existence of this code of practice will be made known to the public so they wish to look at this?
Well, the code of practice will be available in all police stations in Scotland, and it will also be available on the Scottish Government's website. So it will be readily available.
Thank you. Thank you, Margaret.
It's more of a general question, Cabinet Secretary. Given the difficulties surrounding the communication of the policy and stop and search to rank and file officers within Police Scotland, are you confident that the revised code of practice will be properly communicated to these rank and file officers?
Well, this is entirely separate from other forms of stop and search, so and doesn't relate to it. So there haven't been any issues raised around how the existing code of practice has been operating, as it has been for a good number of years now. As I say, it was revised in 2009, but the actual code of practice has been in place since
December 2002.
And the code that we operate here in Scotland is very similar to the code that operates in other parts of the UK.
The gist of the question was about communication. 2009 was prior to the existence of Police Scotland, and the communication problems have resulted since the establishment of Police Scotland.
Yeah, no, I'm confident that the code of practice will be adhered to and it will be properly utilised by officers.
And properly communicated to them.
Well, there's already a process in place, so that's happened since 2002, and there haven't been any problems arisen since then.
We shall see.
Skepticism as usual, but that's all right, Elaine.
This is really a question just for information. I see that currently the minimum amount is £1,000. Has that changed since 2009, and how is that determined?
No, it hasn't been changed, no. Mm-hmm. Still at that level.
That's what was defined in the original
yes.
legislation.
Were there any concerns Cabinet Secretary raised during the consultation by the Human Rights Commission? I note in my note it says that there were few representations which were generally very positive. Were there any negative responses that we might like to hear
from
about?
The Human Rights Commission?
Yes.
No.
They didn't object to
no.
this at all. Were there any negative responses whatsoever?
No.
That's thank you very much. Right, that's the question period over. I now move on to an item two, which is the formal debate. The motion to approve the instrument considered on the previous item by the Cabinet Secretary to move the motion S4M 13076 that the Justice Committee recommends that the draft proceeds of Crime Act 2002 cash searches, Constables in Scotland Code of Practice Order 2015 be approved.
Moved.
Do any members wish to speak in the debate in this motion? No. The question is that motion S4M 13076 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
Thank you very much. As members are aware, we are required to report on all affirmative instruments. Are members content to delegate authority to me and responsibility to sign off this report? Thank you very much. Can I thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary,
thank you.
And your officials for attending the meeting. And I'll suspend just for a couple of minutes to allow witnesses to change over. Thank you very much. I now move on to item three, continuing our inquiries into fatal acts and sudden deaths at Scotland Bill evidence session. And we have three panels of witnesses today in the bill, and the themes emerging from last week's evidence session. I welcome the meeting Jake Molloy, regional organiser of the National Union of Rail, Maritime and Transport Workers, and Ian Tasker, Assistant Secretary at the Scottish Trade Union Congress. And I thank you for your written submissions. And I go straight to questions from members. Gill.
Thank you so much. Can I take you straight to industrial diseases and ask you why you think it's necessary to hold an FAI into every death caused by an industrial disease and what benefit it might, we might get from that?
I should have said, sorry, gentlemen, the microphone will come on automatically, and if one in particular wants to answer, if you just indicate to me and I'll call you. Mr. Tasker.
Yes. The SUC's view is quite clearly it would be impractical to have fatal accident or mandatory fatal accident inquiries into every industrial disease. Our opinion is that the reason we have a serious problem with asbestos-related diseases is because, although the problem was known for most of last century and before that as well, there was never proper inquiries carried out. Our intention in relation to seeking mandatory inquiries for industrial disease is to future-proof against new technologies such as fracking, such as nanotechnology and the materials used in that process, and how in the future that may cause problems for individuals. So it's not about placing a burden on the fatal accident inquiry process to cover old ground. It's about investigating new ground.
Particularly interested in what you said about asbestos. So in regards to asbestos, because I think we know a lot about it, and I think one of the concerns was that one of the problems we've got right now is trying to seek proper compensation, and of course there's processes involved and tribunals and court cases. So you're relaxed about that, and you know that's not the area that you want to be engaged in.
I mean, it may well be that in circumstances particularly, and we haven't come across it in Scotland, but we've come across it in England and Wales, where very young people have developed asbestos-related diseases. And if there was no indication where that exposure had actually happened, then we would suggest that there should be, whether it was a mandatory inquiry or a discretionary inquiry, into that death to try and establish how that death occurred.
Do you think in these circumstances that the Lord Advocate would be the place where that would happen, where there would be discretion in his hands? Do you think that would be that would work for you?
For perhaps diseases that related to known known diseases, known exposures to asbestos, but where there is something that just doesn't fit right with previous histories, then perhaps a discretionary inquiry would be appropriate. But for new diseases or unknown exposures to new processes, new industrial processes, we believe that should be part of the mandatory process.
I'm fairly au fait with a lot of new products that are coming into to the market, particularly in the automotive industry. So I can understand your concerns in that regard. And is that the kind of area that you think that more work needs to be done in these new processes that we're seeing appear?
I mean, I think in the absence of adopting the precautionary principle, which sets strict standards in relation to new processes, we have to have something that ensures that where issues occur, there is a proper and full inquiry into that death at the time, so lessons can be learned and we don't revisit the old problems of asbestos, where I think a lot of people, including workers, buried their hands in the sand and compared to asbestos and the danger it could cause.
OK, thanks very much for that.
Mr Molloy, do you wish to make a comment on mandatory?
Just to concur with what Mr Thasker said, especially the new technologies on fracking, coal gasification and other areas, unknown areas, where we need to ensure that in the event of an accident, we learn everything from it to prevent recurrence.
This is in relation to industrial diseases,
yes.
not an accident
yes.
at work, which of
yes.
course is mandatory.
Yeah.
Margaret.
Good morning, gentlemen. I wonder if you could comment if you still consider there's a problem with delays in holding FEIs, and if so, to comment on Lord Gill's recommendation for early hearings, which wasn't taken up in the bill.
Yeah, I mean, we fully support, I think, the suggestions in Patricia Ferguson, MSP's bill, that there should be timescales set where the Lord Advocate has to take decisions in relation to holding an inquiry. I think that would kickstart the process very much at an early stage. I mean, I was looking at one fatal accident inquiry into the death of a Brazilian national who fell on a wind turbine, and that took 7 years to actually get an inquiry hearing. And you know, we believe that there's things that could have been addressed at an early stage in relation to that specific death, because the individual, although he was not wearing a hard hat, was wearing a harness. So I think there could have been things that were released to the family in relation to that particular death that, in our opinion, may not have prejudiced any criminal inquiry, but may have put the family's minds at rest at an early stage. There was another one in relation to a death in custody and James Bell, and there was an inquiry held in 2014 in relation to the death in 2011. 3 years is perhaps quite long for a death in custody inquiry. But when the fiscal was questioned in relation to why that delay had occurred, they could not answer they could not answer the question. So I think the sheriffs know that there are unacceptable delays in the system, but for some reason the fiscals cannot answer why these delays are occurring.
The question was specifically about the early hearings, and that was a proposal that 3 months maximum from the time of death, there would be a hearing that would help inform the families of
where we were. It would mean the Crown and Procurator Fiscal would have to say why they weren't ready to proceed and give some kind of estimate of when they would think they were ready to proceed, and that it wouldn't just end at that. There would be another time set to review where we were. It's almost like time limits, but it's an early hearing proposal as opposed to a preliminary hearing, which is in the bill, which is all to do with getting ready for trial.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah. We agree with the principle that there's still delays, an example being the death of a lad on Brent Charlie platform 2011. Sure. We only had the prosecution this year, and no information has been disseminated as regards that particular incident. And I think that's put into context when you consider the fact we've had two further fatal accidents of people falling into the sea since that event, and that generates speculation, anxiety, concern amongst the wider workforce, and that's why we are proposing an early hearing in order to deal with the facts, in order to dispel the perceptions, the fears, the concerns, address the issues of the family and share those lessons as early as possible as to the specific facts of that accident in order to prevent recurrence.
Yeah, I think possibly the early hearing is really just to see where we are and how near or imminent the actual fatal inquiry is going to be, or if we're going to go in another direction. I move this on a little bit and see another of the proposals?
This issue, is anybody else going to come in about that? It's very important. I think we all accept there are delays that need cured. I think the issue may be, I think the distinction that Margaret has brought up between an early hearing, which is about process, that if one were to go into substantive matters under some mandatory timescale, it would be almost impossible. It would have to apply to all. And it would be difficult in certain circumstances. It might prejudice an FAI, it might prejudice criminal proceedings, and that it perhaps is too blunt an instrument, if I put it like that. I think we'd all want to see them accelerated, but I speak for myself, I have concerns. If you have a mandatory timescale, it wouldn't be suitable in all circumstances. It might be prejudicial to the relatives and friends who require things, whereas what the Lord Cullen was suggesting was, yes, not just the Lord Advocate telling families and relatives how it's proceeding, but a mandatory early hearing to keep the Crown Office on its toes. You see the difficulty that we might be facing if you make it a mandatory one to announce whether or not there's an FAI?
Yeah, we accept
with facts coming out. Yes.
We accept the difficulties associated with a mandatory timescale, but we still have great frustration in the time that it's taken.
Absolutely. I think it's the cure we're looking at, we're concerned about.
The liaison between the police and the Procurator Fiscals and the HSE, the regulators, seems to have, the cooperation seems to have delivered nothing as regards to reducing that timescale. In fact, in some cases, the timescales have become ever greater, and that's a real concern for us and for workers generally, I would say. Yeah.
Is Lord Cullen's suggestion of an early hearing, is it gaining any ground with you? Do you think given his concerns about going in another direction?
We've actually requested that the regulators look at the AAIB model, the Air Accident Investigation Branch model, of producing a statement of fact at a very early stage in order to diffuse some of the concerns which linger with some of these events.
Margaret, yes.
The main point that would come from an early hearing is to concentrate the Crown and Procurator Fiscal's minds.
Yes.
They would still be very much in charge of the evidence and the presentation of facts. So there wouldn't be anything that would jeopardise, hearing facts too early, but it would concentrate the Crown and Procurator Fiscal's mind and make sure that there was another date where they had to again report back and say why there'd been delays. Now, the other way to address what is perceived as possibly causing a lot of the delays is to ensure that the Crown and Procurator Fiscal Service is properly resourced. And again, the Cullen report recommended a specialised unit to deal with fatal accident inquiries to make sure that there was proper resource within the Crown and Procurator Fiscal to make sure that they delivered as quickly as possible the fatal accident inquiry,
Could I have your comments on that?
Perhaps? I think we very much welcomed the setting up of the fatal inquiry unit. But having studied the findings that are listed on the Scottish Court's website, we do have some concerns whether that is actually speeding up the process. It certainly wasn't designed, I would say, to speed up the process as being the sole priority. It was to have a more effective procedure. So it may well be that we have a more effective procedure. I mean, you mentioned resources, and I think, as far as we're concerned, we still think that the mandatory limits time scales proposed would be workable under a properly resourced regulatory system. And we're not just talking about the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. It has to be the regulator in relation to the HSE as well. We've spoken to a number of families, and you know, they feel that the only way that they are going to actually be comfortable in relation to knowing that things are going to proceed is if there is mandatory timescales.
I wonder if they've had a chance to look at the early hearing plus with the resourcing, because there is a subtle difference between forcing something through on a mandatory basis when you're not prepared, properly prepared with all the evidence at your fingertips to go forward, and just keeping track of it to ensure that you are presenting at the right time, but it can disappear into the ether because, you know, there's yet another hearing and you have to be accountable for why there are delays. Do you think the families have had the opportunity to look at the two different and the distinction?
I think the families that we're in touch with are very much switched on to where the failures in the system are, and they have been studying the proposals. They've studied these proposals, and they've studied Patricia Ferguson's proposals, and you know, they are coming to the conclusion. And I would have to say we're only talking about two or three families who have been part of a process already, yeah, and been let, or felt they have been let down by the process. So you know, they feel that in their experience, setting mandatory timescales to actually get things in motion would address some of the issues that they've had in the past.
Again, I would concur with that, especially on the basis of the 2009 helicopter crash and the families involved with that. They were repeatedly told that a prosecution was coming, and then subsequently told that they should refrain from talking to the press or talking to trade unions or talking to the public in any way. Work with the Crown Office to get the right result, and then subsequently heard on the television that a fatal accident inquiry was to be held and that there would be no prosecution. Quite clearly, there's problems there in the Fiscal's Office and the Crown Office dealing with the families.
Absolutely. Yeah. Okay. I think we agree with that. I think it's the concern about just whether or not in all circumstances having time limits. I'm thinking about deaths abroad now. Mandatory time limit not be a good idea when you've had a death abroad, and we're bringing that in to this bill as well. But I leave that just now, so I've got a cue. Christian, this is on the same thing about delays, is it?
Yeah, talk about death abroad, but maybe later on.
Leave that till later, yeah. Just do delays.
Are you on the delays?
You're on delay. I'll take you, then I'll take Patricia, then I'll take Roddy. That's the order I've got people on delays. Just on delays. Okay, thank you.
Morning, gentlemen. In terms of...
Oh, sorry, it was Christian. Christian, then okay. Patricia, then Roddy, right.
Thank you very much. Just to clarify, Mr. Molloy, what you talked about when you talk about the Piper Alpha and when you talk the AIB, you know, I want to be very clear on this. The mandatory will cause problems with these very complicated cases, because we know that there needs to be a proper investigation. I like the fact what you said, we need a statement of fact to start with, but do you see it in this example? Was it the problem of a statement of fact, or was it a slowing down, for example, the Piper Alpha? Was it not a parliamentary procedure which made it very slow at the start? Where did come the delay in the example that you give?
Well, we've had five helicopter incidents, and within 48 hours of each, we've had a statement of fact from the AIB, which, with the most recent one at Sumbra, allowed us to consider the industry, that is, to consider putting helicopters back in the air again, having voluntarily grounded them because we didn't have bad knowledge. So we got a statement of fact from the regulator to say there was no mechanical issue, none whatsoever. Investigations would go on as to why that event occurred. If I was to replay that in the event of the Brent Charlie death, for example, the facts were very quickly known as to how the individual's ropes were cut through and how he came to be in the sea. A statement of fact would have been that the ropes were cut through as a consequence of an unseen piece of steel, and that investigations will ongo as to how that steel came to be there, etc., etc., etc. You know, I don't see that a statement of fact jeopardises prosecutions. I feel that we've become such a litigious society that lawyers are advising companies now not to talk about events, not to provide facts. Similarly, the lawyers providing the HSE are telling the HSE they can't comment, and so we have this situation where the families and the workforce, the greater workforce around any incident, start to make up stories for themselves. That cannot be good for society as a whole. It can't be good for the Crown Office or the Fiscal's Office or for how we deal with death at work, which is why I think an early statement of fact and then a time frame based on that fact be introduced as to projections of when an inquiry will be held and if it's likely prosecutions will occur.
So you wouldn't want to put under statement of fact a time frame for that statement of fact to come out, because of course investigation can take several time to have its facts. So you would want a timetable after the statement of fact have been approached.
Well, as the Chair said, I think that then puts the impetus, it puts accountability on the regulator, the police and industry to conduct the investigation in good time to try and meet those time frames.
No, I'm not sure if we have...
If you just summarise, please, for me, before I go to Patricia. Are you saying there's no time scale for a statement of fact? No time scale for that?
I would say that a statement of fact could be done within a matter of days after an event.
In every case? You see, this is the problem.
Yes, problem.
You've quoted very good examples. Mm-hmm. But if we're changing the law, we change it for every case and for every foreseeable circumstance, so there's no unintended consequences of it.
Mm-hmm. Well, I mean, I know that the HSE already investigating an incident produced an early day incident report, which is essentially a statement of fact to the Minister as to what they've found in their initial investigations. It is little more than that. It doesn't prevent the investigation ongoing. It simply is a statement of fact as to what occurred with the incident.
So just to clarify for me, what are you talking about? You're talking about in all circumstances a statement of fact within some kind of timescale?
Yes.
And which is?
The timescale?
Statement of fact.
Well, that would be determined on the event. I mean, if we're talking about multiple deaths, then it's obviously going to take a bit longer. I don't know that we can have a mandatory time frame. Sorry.
Right.
Sorry.
We don't have it for that.
Sorry.
But then once you've got the statement of fact,
then you
have a time limit for the announcement whether it's an FAI.
Yes.
And that's a period of 3 months.
Yes.
Thank you. Just to clarify.
Yeah,
that,
I'm happy with that. Mr. Tasker is happy with that as well.
Yeah, I think a good example of where it worked well was, and it wasn't a fatal accident inquiry, it was a public inquiry, it was the Stotline inquiry. And that was a very complex investigation. It could be argued, I think, that again families were not communicated with properly, but it was quite clear in the early days, and it was established in the early days what actually caused that explosion. I think there was a lot of, and it was mentioned earlier in relation to rumour about what other things that might have caused that tragedy, and that doesn't help the families either. And you know, I think being more open and transparent in relation to what's been found at an earlier stage, and I accept that can't be a mandatory time frame in relation to that, but as soon as any regulator is in a position to issue a statement of fact, that should be communicated to the families.
Thank you. Thank you. Patricia, followed by Rod.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, gentlemen. I think I'm right in saying, from my consideration of the government's current bill, that there are no timescales mentioned there. Was that a disappointment?
I think certainly for the SDUC that is a disappointment, and we appreciate that they've taken on a lot or they're taking on some points from your particular proposals. And I think our biggest disappointment is that they are not taking on board the timescales which we believe would push the process forward and encourage the Lord Advocate to take these decisions. If there's mandatory timescales, it will become part of a process where perhaps, hopefully, these decisions are being taken well within these timeframes.
And if there was a time frame of, say, 6 months before, within which the Lord Advocate had the opportunity to say, yes, there will, or no, I won't apply for the Faith Accident Inquiry, do you think 6 months is a long enough period for that, providing that there is a mechanism that allows the Lord Advocate, where the matter is perhaps particularly complex, for example, to say, well, in this instance, for these reasons, I will take 7 months or 9 months or a year. Would that be reasonable?
I think providing the reasons for that decision were properly communicated to families or to their legal representatives or to trade unions, indeed. You know, we will work, and we have worked with families to perhaps make sure their expectations of when things are going to happen are realistic. And I think we would do that on that basis, that if the Lord Advocate felt there was a genuine need for an extension to any timescales, then I think it would be irresponsible of the trade union movement not to support that decision.
Thank you. Thank you, Convener.
Rod first, please.
Thank you, Convener. Do you agree that the public interest, as opposed to the interest of the families, distinguishing those, the public interest is that criminal investigations should take precedence over a fatal accident inquiry, and that anything that might prejudice or impact on that should be discouraged, and that should be foremost in the Lord Advocate's mind?
I think that is very much the case, but we think there could be more done, particularly in relation to, Jake's already mentioned, reports by the accident investigation branch. We would point to the Marine and Maritime and Coast Guard Agency and the reports that they issue very quickly in relation to deaths at sea. And they do have a disclaimer, basically, that these reports will not prejudice any future criminal investigation. So we think there are more that can be done. While it is clear that the public interest has to come first, there's more that could be done to publish reports into fatal accidents at work. Well, we're mainly talking about fatal accidents at work, that actually helps us to perhaps look at how we improve safety standards at an earlier stage than we actually do now.
I'm just trying to pull this together. What the more that you think could be done is back to this idea of a statement of facts, is it?
Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Would it not be the case that sometimes a statement of facts, not the ones you've quoted, but mechanical failure, well, that might as well, but a statement of fact as such might prejudice criminal proceedings by the fact being put forward and not being challenged? You see, I think I have absolute concerns about delays and the family's position, and fully appreciate the FAIs and the public interest, and fully appreciate that we have to cure lack of safety measures in workplaces as swiftly as possible. My concern is that by taking the steps that you're suggesting, you prejudice criminal proceedings. You may prejudice criminal proceedings by having time limits. You may prejudice an FAI. I mean, say a decision's taken within your time not to hold an FAI, and then other evidence comes to light. Do we then hold an FAI? This is the problem. We want to cure something. I don't know if your remedies cure them in the way you wish over all FAIs. You see, what would happen if you had a time limit and the Crown say, well, we're not holding an FAI, we've done a statement of facts, we've decided not to hold one within your time limits, and a year later they think, we should have held an FAI.
I mean, we're not aware of any circumstances where that's been...
No, because we don't have time limits just now.
Yeah,
but if you have them,
but
what would that do?
The decision to hold a fatal accident inquiry, we believe, has been taken far too late. It's not been communicated to families.
I agree with all that. Yeah. I'm just posing to you. You set a time limit for 6 months, and the Lord Abbot says, I'm not holding an FAI, and a year later, evidence comes to light somewhere or other that there should have been an FAI. What do we do? What happens?
I mean, we can't... If there's been a full investigation, there's been a decision to take or not to take a criminal prosecution. You know, there has been a full investigation into the circumstances relating to that death. We would question what new evidence is going to come to light. And if that is the case, given that we have double jeopardy in relation to criminal prosecutions, why can't we have a process introduced in law that actually would allow that situation to be revisited?
Well, given that double jeopardy has been eliminated, that's for very serious offences, of course. But I think that I just put that to you as a difficulty that might happen as an unintended consequence of worthy proposals to speed them up and to keep families informed, but just some of the difficulties in law that might come from it that are unintended. Does anybody else want to go on further about before we go on? It's an important point. Christian, Patricia, you want to back in after Christian?
Yeah, Mr. Tesley. Can you please clarify? Because you answered my question saying that you didn't want mandatory time scales. When you answered the question of Ms. Ferguson about you were disappointed that the Scottish Government didn't introduce mandatory time scales. I'm confused. You know, do you want mandatory time scales? Or do you realise that we cannot have mandatory scales? You know, I can't see a clear evidence from you this morning.
I think our preference would be for mandatory timescales, but Patricia Ferguson raises an important point that where the Lord Advocate feels that these mandatory timescales cannot be adhered to for whatever reason.
So do you agree with the Lord Advocate?
He should have discretion to extend these mandatory timescales if he can provide an adequate explanation to the families that he needs more time.
Would you want mandatory timescale to start with? Yes or no?
Yes.
Well, let me take Patricia first, then you can come in. Patricia.
Mention has been made of criminal prosecutions against companies, firms, individuals who might be involved in these very unfortunate and tragic incidents. But I presume that were there to be a criminal investigation, you would not expect time scales to kick in until the conclusion of those particular prosecutions.
Yeah. That's correct, because I've already stated that we believe that the criminal prosecution in the public interest has to take priority, but following the conclusion of criminal proceedings, and whether that, particularly where that's a guilty plea, where there hasn't, in the family's view, been a full examination and a full disclosure of the circumstances relating to the death, mandatory timescales in relation to the announcement of that fatal accident inquiry are, we believe, vitally important.
Mm-hmm. If I may just follow up on that, Convener, because I was very interested in the point about the public interest being possibly different from that of the families, or possibly being superior to that of the families. And I think Mr. Tasker makes a very interesting point about criminal proceedings. Because I think I'm right in thinking that Mr. Tasker's had some involvement in criminal proceedings where there was a guilty plea.
Yeah.
For that reason, there was no exploration in public of the facts and
yeah.
no reason or rationale given to anyone involved in that particular tragedy.
I think I've had a involvement in a number of cases. I've already mentioned Stotline, but clearly a few years ago there was four fatalities in open cast mining, mm-hmm. Which the companies pled guilty to, and the family's position there was extreme anger that they go to court and they don't hear the full facts in relation to the circumstances of the loss of their loved ones. And we supported some of these families in relation to raising these concerns with the then Lord Advocate. That did lead to changes, we believe, in the initially setting up the Health and Safety Division.
I think we're sympathetic. I'm looking for perhaps a cure for that when somebody pleads and you know, we don't have a full exposure of what events took place. Roddy, do you have a solution to that?
Just on this point of the Lord Advocate being able to seek to extend the mandatory timetable, saying that he would need, I think you suggested he would need to get the agreement of the victims' families. How's that going to work?
No, I may have used that word, I don't know, but we would say providing it's communicated to families in relation to why he requires that time.
So he would still have to. And what's the sanction if the victims' families don't agree with the Lord Advocate?
I mean, to me, the Lord Advocate is in a position to take that decision, communicate it to the families. The families can then take whatever view they want on that decision. But as I said, you know, I think you would, providing the reasons were set out, you would have legal advisers perhaps engaging with families saying, yes, here are the reasons why this extension has been is required, and we would support that. You may well get families who are very much displeased about the proposal to extend the time limit, but that actually happens at the moment. Yeah. You see participants in fatal accident inquiries actually, we would suggest trying to introduce things that are not investigations in relation to the circumstances leading to the death.
But isn't that in danger of creating something which is different from what the fatal accident inquiry is supposed to be, which is an inquiry, not something that creates legal rights, duties and obligations? And you're talking about lawyers being involved in advising the families.
I mean, lawyers are involved in advising families at fatal accident inquiries at the moment, it has to be said, because they need that, because they've not been part of a legal process before. We've got trade unions that support members at fatal accident inquiries. So it doesn't take away from the fact that it's still an inquiry, but that support is there for people that are actually taking part in a process that is totally alien to them.
If I could supplement that, if I can, using the example we put in the written papers on the Brent Bravo tragedy in 2003, you know, the families there and the workforce at large felt that the scope of the inquiry didn't bring out the learnings which the industry could have done, because again, plea bargaining occurred. The fiscal's office took the view that having got a guilty plea, initially there was no need for an inquiry. We did some lobbying, we got the inquiry, but then the sheriff took the very narrow remit to look at the specifics without the input of the families, without the input of the trade unions, without the input of safety representatives or the workforce at large. Had that occurred, then the time frame adopted by the Lord Advocate for holding the inquiry could reasonably have been expected to be extended because of what we saw at the time as the complexities of the corporate structures of the company involved. So I think what Mr. Tasker is saying is that we could, and I think families would reasonably accept an extension to any mandatory time frame, whatever it may be, if they are consulted as to the justification for that extension and given the reasons and the details to why there's a need to broaden out that investigation to look at other aspects of the deaths.
Is that you, John?
Morning, gents. you had some robust questioning there, and some people might
assume that the present situation is perfect. It's far from perfect, which is precisely why we're sitting here. I wonder if you would care to comment on the points that have been raised about reinvestigation. I've got the policy objectives of the bill in front of me here. It's six bullet points, and the fifth bullet point is the policy objectives of the bill are to permit FEIs to be reopened if new evidence arises, or if the evidence is so substantial to permit a completely new inquiry to be held. I mean, clearly you don't want to come to that position, but you'd be supportive of that if the need arose, presumably. Absolutely.
Yeah, I think obviously the STUC would be supportive of that, but and we would agree with your statement that we don't particularly want to get to that, yeah. But if we are going to have an effective fatal accident inquiry system, then that kind of I think, very strong test at the end, I think, would be welcome.
Can I ask you two, please? You both RMT and STUC make representations for a greater involvement for the role of trade unions in FEIs, and I personally would be very supportive of that. Can you explain what that role would be and what barriers there are, or perceived barriers there may be at the moment, to active participation for workers' representation?
I mean, I think I would again go back to the case in relation to the Stotline public inquiry, where the STUC General Counsel in the very early days took a position on that, that regardless of the fact whether it was a trade unionised workplace or not, we would support the families and the injured workers as long as they required that support. And that included actually helping them to learn how to campaign to get their public inquiry, but as part of the process, it was very much clear that the trade union representation was not welcome by I would say by the inquiry team. It was not welcome when we were supporting the families at the court hearing, at which they were deeply disappointed. It was not welcome. We were not welcome there. So the fact that, you know, I think we should very much be seen as part of the process where we have trade union members. I think the Stotline was a terrible tragedy, and it's probably not something that we could do on a day-in, day-out basis. But, you know, families need that kind of support, whether it's trade unions or whether it's some other body. They need that kind of support throughout the process, and I don't think they get it at the moment.
Of course, we're told that their interests are represented by the Procurator Fiscal. Is that not the case?
Sorry, yeah, I've got no, it's not the case. I've been involved now with four fatal accident inquiries, two public inquiries.
To correct you, John, I think the committee is well aware that the Crown, the PF, represents the public interest.
Yes.
And that has been confusing for families and relatives over the years. Mm. I'm glad progress has been made to embrace them more into the process, which is confusing when it's someone that, you know, that has died that you're very close to. But I think we're well aware that that's the distinction that is made in the process. And that, in fact, the families are quite often bystanders in the process, which we're hoping is improving and will change as this progresses.
Maybe if I was to rephrase that, then there's a perception widely held by families, and I've been involved in fatal accident inquiries, that, you know, death in custody, for instance, where they say, well, who's representing my interests? You know, the fiscal's representing a range of interests. So clearly the status quo, what other people may think, isn't desirable. So,
well, what I was going to say was that if during that entire period, I've never once been asked by the Procurator Fiscal's office, has a union been approached by the Fiscal's office or the Lord Advocate's office to offer up evidence? The only time we did endeavour to submit evidence, we were told that the evidence that we put up was the rantings of a disgruntled ex-employee. That disgruntled ex-employee was the primary auditor of the global corporation and had produced data which demonstrated that the corporation had failed fundamentally in its duty of care, but it was dismissed as I say, the rantings of a disgruntled employee. That's why we feel that there's absolutely a need to engage with all parties, all stakeholders, if you like, prior to determining the scale of an inquiry, the timing of an inquiry, etc. And it also allows the families to hear directly from workforce representatives, from the trade unions, and from fellow workers safety representatives and the like, again, many of whom could have made significant contributions to many of the fatal accident inquiries, certainly the four that I've been involved with. But on the flip side, if you look at the public inquiries, where we did get that sort of input, the outcomes were significantly different and far more encompassing, with far greater recommendations, and made significant differences. It made a difference from those inquiries as opposed to the fatal accident inquiries, most of which, apart from one that I've been involved with, have made little or no difference at all to operations or preventing recurrence of accidents.
Can I ask about the outcomes then? There's a suggestion that the outcomes should be binding. We heard from Lord Cullen last week that that would be challenging. In fact, it would almost preempt the presumption of legislative, give them an authority they don't presently have. How would you see any findings being put into place? Because we also heard from Families Against Corporate Killing that a real frustration that whilst one death was being addressed, because action hadn't been taken, another six had taken place in the interim.
Mm-hmm. Well, again, to use another example from the most recent public inquiry, a fatal accident inquiry into the 2009 tragedy, during the course of investigation and subsequently the decision not to prosecute and then hold an FAI, we were privy to evidence from a trade union official who, to quote, said that four of the five incidents we've had with helicopters would never have occurred with the company that I work for. And he was quite adamant in giving evidence to the minister that was sitting in the meeting that was the case. And, in fact, as regards that 2009 accident, it couldn't possibly have happened because the helicopter would never have left the hangar. That kind of evidence, I think, is fundamental to the investigation, the inquiry process, but was excluded. It wasn't considered, because there was no mechanism for the trade union input, for workforce input, as part of that investigation. The families met with the Crown Office, the Procurator Fiscal's Office, on several occasions, but there was never an invitation put to the trade unions, any trade union, to be involved in that.
Right, so these are issues we can certainly put the Solicitor General when the Solicitor General appears before the committee. Yes.
Yeah. I would point you towards a fatal accident inquiry that involved a mother and the deaths of a mother and her two children in a road traffic accident just north of Montrose. It took place in January 2008. The inquiry was four years later. Again, you know, I would say an unreasonable delay. But the sheriff, in his judgment, I think, expressed disbelief that these mobile cranes are not subject to MOT tests. And he also expressed an opinion, there was evidence put forward that the UK government was in contravention of the European directive in relation to that. And he made a recommendation that the UK government should take that on board and bring forward legislation as a matter of urgency. Now, that has not been done. I realise that there is this difficulty between devolved and reserved responsibilities, and obviously the road traffic regulations are reserved, but where a sheriff can make legally binding recommendations in relation to devolved powers within the Parliament, then we think that should happen.
Should that be fettered in any way? Should a sheriff be able to come up and make any judgment and know that it's going to be enforced?
Well, again, I mean, as regards the enforcement aspect, if a judge, a sheriff, is making recommendations and they're in the public domain, and there's a requirement on those against whom the recommendations are being made to respond in the public domain, I think that puts a great deal of emphasis on the respective companies to respond in a positive way. I think it would act as a great deterrent, if you like, to bad practice and promote good practice, if it was transparent, if it was open. The idea of those against whom the recommendations are being made simply responding through correspondence to the Lord Advocate or whoever, I don't think is healthy. It's not open, it's not transparent, and it's not conducive to what we're trying to achieve, and that is to learn from and see significant improvement.
You mentioned their Accident Investigation Board. Is there anything we can learn from them? Presumably, if there's a finding there, people don't just note it and move on, they act on it.
Well, in most cases, yes. I mean, it took 10 drilling workers and 2 fatal accident inquiries to see the drilling industry change. And we haven't, and as a consequence of Sheriff McClernand's recommendations, we got that change eventually. And we, touch wood, we haven't killed a drilling worker since that hearing in 2003. We've come close, but we haven't actually had a fatal accident in the drilling sector since, because there were quite significant recommendations made there, which not only the employers acted on, the regulator used to enforce to a far greater extent. And I think that's another aspect of recommendations, that the regulator needs to be seen to be acting on those recommendations as well, just as happens in the aviation industry.
Okay. One final point, if I may, please, to Mr. Tasker. It's about improvements to access to legal aid. Mm-hmm. You've made comment on that. Could you expand on that, please?
I mean, we are certainly concerned in relation to, and I came across one inquiry where the individual had represented themselves purely on the basis that funding was not made available to them. And it has to be said, it was in a sheriff court in the North East, and the individual who was representing himself following the death of his son was absolutely taken to pieces by the sheriff, because that individual, you know, could not present his case in a way that sheriff was obviously expecting. Now, I think one case where that is the case is one case too many, and that was purely because they could not afford to get legal representation, and again, they did not feel that the fiscal was the appropriate person to represent their interests. So we believe that individuals should have access to legal aid if they want to be represented at a fatal accident inquiry.
Okay, thank you.
Agree with that, because confidence in the Crown Office, the Property Fiscal's Office, as time goes on, wanes, and the families of those killed have little confidence by the time the inquiry comes round, and so come to organisations like ourselves looking for support to get legal representation to represent their interests. Yeah.
Okay, thank you both.
I've got another two questions, Christian, and if there's a supplementary, I think, and then Elaine is something completely different. Before I move to that, under section 10 of the bill, subsection 1E, it says the following persons may participate in inquiry proceedings in relation to the death of a person. And subsection E says any other person who the sheriff is satisfied has an interest in the inquiry. Would that not cover, if appropriate, trade union representation?
Well, I'll stand corrected, but the sheriff, as far as we're aware from our experience, hasn't been involved until the inquiry has actually been staged. It's been the fiscal's office.
And yes. The bill makes that plain. I may be misreading it, but the persons who may participate, and there's a list of mandates, you know, you would expect the spouse or civil partner and so mm-hmm. on, or an employer if it was an employee's death, mm-hmm. but there's a section, subsection E, any other person who the sheriff is satisfied has an interest in the inquiry. Does the sheriff not have power, as master of the proceedings, as it were, to say, well, I would like to hear from, say, the trade union? In those circumstances.
That's what the bill says, and I would hope that would...
Well, I'm just wondering. I just put that there because I looked at the subsection. Christian, what's your one on?
No, I just wanted to come back on the sheriff. On the decision, recommendation of a sheriff. You said that there will be a difference between reserve matter and devolved matters, but somehow that if we are devolved matters, the sheriff recommendation should be taken forward straight away. Or what kind of mechanism would you see?
I mean, where I'm, my thoughts, and it's just come to me in the last couple of days, is that, you know, what power would a sheriff in our distinct legal jurisdiction have to instruct the UK government to bring forward legislation to ensure that mobile cranes were subject to MOTs? I don't know. You know, that's maybe one for the constitutional experts. But
way, respectfully suggesting, and
I think that would be, I think there is the opportunity for sheriffs to raise these issues in the appropriate manner.
Our practicing, microphone, please. Yes,
I should refer to my declaration of interest as a member of the Faculty of Advocates. I'm not persuaded that, in terms of the sheriff's role, there is any distinction constitutionally between devolved and reserved.
There we are. Yeah. It's good to have an expert.
Yeah.
But would you agree on this? That, you know, it doesn't matter if it's the UK government or the Scottish government. Recommendations, of course, are important. But, yeah, you know, I don't see how we can, a mechanism to make it stronger than recommendations, is there?
I mean, there has to be a recommendation made by a sheriff, and I'm going back to that one in relation to mobile cranes, many years ago now, has not been taken forward because it is purely a recommendation. It carries no legal power, basically. So that's why we think that was a mother and her two daughters that were killed, a father whose family was wiped out. But, you know, the sheriff's recommendation, a justifiable recommendation in our view, has been totally ignored by the UK government because it is purely a sheriff's recommendation. It is not a legally binding instruction, basically.
So you're saying, in fact, that the two governments are not responding the same way. The two administration, devolved administration and reserve administration, are not responding the same way. So you're not, is the reason you maybe think that we should be stronger? But I was
maybe just complicating matters for myself in relation to the devolved, reserved, and I'm glad that we've got that clarification. You know, and actually,
let's keep to the principle of whether or not a recommendation should be enforceable. And there could be issues with that, because we heard from Lord Cullen. I want to move on to explore something that we haven't explored, and conscious of time, Elaine.
Yeah, the bill, as it in Section 6, states that where deaths occur out with the United Kingdom and the person is ordinary resident in Scotland, and the person's body has been brought back to Scotland, a fatal provisions of the bill would apply in those cases. Obviously, in some industries, in fishing industry, for example, it might not be possible to retrieve the body of a person who's died. I think possibly the oil and gas industry is covered by Section 5 and the Petroleum Act of 1998, though I'm not familiar with its provisions. But particularly, there are some instances where people employed by British companies and who are ordinary residents in Scotland will die overseas and the body is not retrievable. Should those also be included in this legislation?
I would say yes, because, I mean, looking at the consultation that's ongoing right now for the EU directive for offshore, that talks about extending best practice globally to corporations. Mm. So if, going back to the recommendations aspect, if a fatal accident inquiry were to be held and those recommendations were shared, then it could have the impetus to improve health and safety understandings and operations and share those learnings and prevent recurrence on a global scale.
Mm-hmm. I think one of the arguments about that has been, again, the counter-arguments perhaps, is that it would be very difficult to enforce any recommendations in another jurisdiction.
Our view is that, you know, we're supportive, certainly in relation to where a worker is killed abroad, that fatal accident inquiries are carried out because it has to be said that we have some of the best developed health and safety legislation and regulation in the UK. Mm. A lot of other countries don't have that level of sophistication in their regulation and enforcement. But that does not mean to say that for UK companies or Scottish companies operating abroad, that they can't learn from a fatal accident inquiry from a worker that is killed abroad and actually make changes within their own organisation to ensure that the risk of workers being killed abroad is reduced. So we think that there are positive things that could come out of that, but I think we appreciate that perhaps in some countries even carrying out that level of investigation may prove difficult because of the circumstances within these countries.
Does Police Scotland were quite concerned about the implications for the police as to whether it would be them that would be expected to do the investigations elsewhere if there were criminal investigations and so on?
In our view, and the HSE are probably not going to like this, but if it was a death at work, you know, we would say that the regulator in the UK should investigate that death. But you know, clearly there would be resource implications in relation to the HSE and their capacity to carry out that additional task.
I'm conscious of time, so if it's yes, please.
Yeah, just to advise on this, I see from the IMT submission that you talked about the problem of ports having on the convenience flag, for example. I've got great difficulty to understand on your submission what you are saying, how we can override of a jurisdiction and a council, how we can put that in that bill, how can we override over jurisdictions abroad of when you talk about investigations?
I don't know that we're arguing we override other jurisdictions, but we're arguing certainly that marine accidents should be subject to the same level of inquiry if they're happening in UK waters, and that irrespective of the flag of convenience, excuse me, irrespective of that flag of convenience, because it's occurred in the UK state, there has to be learnings to ensure that vessels entering the UK waters are fit for purpose, that they're acting in accordance with the jurisdictions of this country. Because, again, because of resources, the ability of the MCA to look at these vessels to ensure and police and inspect simply isn't there. So if we're not looking at it by way of inquiry, we've got no means of stopping or preventing recurrence.
I understand in UK waters, but I've got difficulties when you're talking about other jurisdictions' waters.
Includes non-UK territorial waters as well, so I think it's covered by that, Christian.
No, I was just saying that you know,
talking about practicalities.
Both of you are not asking to duplicate what's happening abroad. Whatever we feel, the level of scrutiny is as good as it is in the UK.
That's what we're trying to achieve.
Yeah. I'm moving on. Excellent. I've given you one of my crushing looks, I hope. Can I say I bring an end to this evidence session? Thank you very much for evidence, gentlemen. We were testing you because that's what we're required to do to make sure we get the law operating in the interests of everyone properly. So I hope you accept that. I'm going to suspend for... Do you want a little bit? 5 minutes? 5 minutes. Suspend for 5 minutes to allow witnesses to change over. Thank you very much. Thank you. Resuming business, I welcome the second panel of witnesses to the meeting. Alistair McNab, Head of Operations in Scotland at the Health and Safety Executive, Dr. Gary Morrison, Executive Director of Medical of the Mental Health Welfare Commission for Scotland, and Cathy Asante. Excellent. Legal Officer, Human Rights-Based Approach, Scottish Human Rights Commission. I thank you all for your written submissions, and I go straight to questions from members. Ah, Elaine.
Can I ask
Roddy Margaret.
Alison. Lord Cullen's recommendations have not been totally taken forward in terms of deaths during people who are being... and who are being detained, if you like, who are not just within legal custody, but in mental health detention and others. And I wondered if you had any comments as to whether you thought Lord Cullen's recommendations should be implemented in full in that regard, or whether there were problems with that.
And I make it plain, sorry again, that if you just indicate that you wish to respond, I'll call you and your light will come on, microphone. Who wants to address that? Ms. Asante.
Thank you. It is our view that there is a gap in relation to protection of the right to life in relation to those who die in mental health detention. In terms of the requirements of Article 2, the right to life under the European Convention on Human Rights, there is a duty to investigate deaths, particularly of those who are in custody of the state, in recognition of the fact that they're in a very vulnerable position. And the European Court also recognises that people who are in mental health detention are in a particularly vulnerable situation. So when looking at Article 2, the European Court has set down certain requirements that are necessary for investigations of this nature. And there are some essential elements to them. Firstly, inquiries must be independent, they must be effective, they must have promptness and reasonable expedition, must be an element of public scrutiny, the next of kin must be involved, and they must be initiated by the state. Now, we know that there is a system for investigating deaths that do happen in hospitals, including in mental health detention, but at the moment it's quite variable, it's spread across a number of agencies, and we think that there are gaps. There's essentially no independent formal inquiry that takes place as a matter of course for deaths of that nature. So for that reason, we do think that deaths when people are in detention under mental health legislation should be brought within the category of mandatory FAIs, as Lord Cullen suggested. But having taken into account some of the discussion that's arisen since his report, we do think that there's some merit in considering a two-tier system whereby there's an initial investigation carried out to rule out deaths perhaps from natural causes or ones where there's really no further cause for concern, and that mandatory FAIs should apply in all other cases. The Mental Welfare Commission have put forward a proposal for a two-tier system of that nature, and we think that merits further consideration.
Dr. Morrison.
Yeah, but I suppose our position, simply put, is that we don't agree that there should be mandatory FAIs for all people who die whilst detained under the Mental Health Act. But neither do we think that the current system is adequate, broadly speaking, for the reasons that Cathy has outlined, that the current system doesn't comply with the requirements of Article 2, particularly that of independence. And also, we don't think the current system provides adequate public reassurance. As part of our submission, we gave you some information about a bit of work we did looking at the deaths of people detained in a year. And just very, very quickly to aid you, in 1 year there were 78 deaths. We managed to review the case notes of 73 of them. So of the 73 people who died, 39 were of expected natural causes. That included a 67-year-old man with alcohol-related brain damage who had cancer and died in a hospice. A further 14 were unexpected but natural. So that included people who died suddenly of a heart attack or a stroke. So we would argue that if you looked at these 54 out of the 73 deaths and had a mandatory fatal accident inquiry for all of them, that's not really an efficient use of resources. And probably importantly, would be distressing for the families of the people who've died whilst detained, yes, but of natural causes. So as Cathy's mentioned, we're suggesting that there should be changes to the current system to introduce more independent oversight, more public reassurance, but not automatically having a fatal accident inquiry in all cases.
Other in legal custody, for example, and any death will be subject to an FAI, even if it is for a death from natural causes. So why is that different when you're in legal custody or subject to a compulsory treatment, for example?
Yeah, no, I appreciate that, and I know that was one of the arguments that Lord Cullen made when he appeared before you a few weeks ago. I mean, I suppose I would say that, you know, what they choose to do in legal custody is up to them, but looking at the information we've got, it just doesn't seem proportionate, effective, or reasonable to do FAIs on 54 people who have quite obviously died of either expected or unexpected, but natural causes. Mm. And as you were hearing about in the your evidence session earlier, FAIs don't happen quickly. Families get very anxious and distressed by them. And I think that's one of the bigger or more significant arguments about this is the distress that it could cause families.
From an HSE perspective, I mean, the situation is really the investigation phase. So I would agree that in many cases, we would not be investigating all of these. In fact, most of them would not be mandatory reportable to HSE in any case. Mm-hmm. The way we would learn about them would be selected ones would be put to HSE by the Crown Office Procurator Fiscal Service, either their Health and Safety Specialist Division or SFIU, the Fatalities Investigation Unit. Would they think there might be a work-related element, they would then contact HSE. If HSE does initial inquiries to establish the circumstances to decide whether or not further investigation would be required. And you know, my feeling is that works fine at the moment. As far as FAIs, it's certainly true we haven't been involved in many FAIs. To give you some context, HSE investigates between 25 to 35 work-related deaths a year, sadly, and we give evidence to approximately 10 to 15 FAIs per year, some of which are pretty complex and require us to have legal representation to explore the policy and sectoral issues behind them. The vast majority are relatively straightforward and simple and have quick investigation. So I heard earlier evidence that suggests everything takes too long, but very many investigations are complete within 3 months. There are complex ones that certainly go beyond a year. So we wouldn't have a difficulty with the investigation phase. We're happy that COPFS refer the right ones to us, and we can then take a view and feedback and report to the Crown Office whether or not we think there's any potential breach of health and safety law. And for police-related ones, we have working arrangements with PIRC to investigate relevant ones as well.
So we'd be looking at something either an addition to one of the sections or a separate section for deaths occurring when detained under mental health legislation. Is that what you're saying? Taking your two-tier test?
Yes, I think we would be looking at, I think it's section 6 of the bill. And what we had suggested was that that section could include in the mandatory category deaths in mental health detention, but could also have an exclusion in the way that some of the other categories do, where the Lord Advocate is satisfied that the circumstances of the death have been sufficiently established during the course of an inquiry by the Mental Welfare Commission in this instance.
Not a presumption of FAI, but mandatory. I was thinking there'd be a presumption, you might argue, it could be a presumption of FAI subject to other tests as presented by the Mental Welfare Commission.
I think that would amount to broadly the same effect, however it were drafted.
Yes.
It amounts to a presumption that it would take place unless it was ruled out by the Mental Welfare Commission.
Yep. Okay. Anybody else on this particular point? No, Rod? Then Margaret, then Alison.
Yeah, could I just kind of direct your attention to the policy memorandum where the Scottish Government refers to the Royal College of Psychiatrists' graduated scale of investigations, adverse incidents, critical incident reviews involving a consultant from another health board area, significant adverse incident reviews involving another health board, then independent investigation by the Mental Welfare Commission, and then finally an independent investigation by the Procurator Fiscal and possibly a discretionary FAI. They talk about possibly formalising this system and rationalising it, not necessarily in legislation. And in particular, in terms of the powers of the Mental Welfare Commission, would it not be more appropriate for that to be in mental health legislation rather than this legislation? So I really would like some comments on that bit of the policy memorandum.
What page
is
that?
Sorry. It's page 22.
Page 22. Dr. Morrison, perhaps.
Yeah, I mean, recognising that there seems to be, notwithstanding, that there is certainly a case for minimising the number of fatal accident inquiries, particularly in cases of people dying of natural causes. Is this not one way forward?
It's certainly an option, and it's something we've had discussions with the Royal College of Psychiatrists about, and that may well be what they're referring to, because at the moment there's substantial variability in the system, and particularly there's variability in the degree of independence. So in a substantial number of critical incident or even significant adverse incident reviews that happen, there'll be nobody from out with the local service. And that runs the risk of falling foul of the Article 2 requirement for independence. So we would be seeking, were our suggestion to be taken forward, some more either powers or agreement with local services to oversee and to direct their local incident review to make sure that either they've taken it sufficiently seriously and also that any conclusions are robust. I suppose whether this happens under the legislation you're currently considering or under mental health legislation is possibly more of a discussion for lawyers and draftsmen. But I do know that the second stage of amendments to the Mental Health Bill, I think, closes this week. So they might not welcome a suggestion that we change something at this stage.
Yes, Ms. Asante.
I would support what Dr. Morrison is saying about some of the Article 2 requirements that are missing from that graduated scale of investigations, and that's really where our concern arises, and particularly around independence, but also around public scrutiny and whether the next of kin is involved, which is variable in this system at the moment. So we do think that more needs to be added into the system to make sure that all of the Article 2 requirements are met. Whether that happens in this legislation or mental health legislation, we don't have a particular view on. We did actually, I think, raise this in relation to the Mental Health Bill, that this was a gap that needed to be addressed. But since it hasn't been taken up in that forum, we think this is a good opportunity to take it forward.
Thank you. Margaret, followed by Alison, please.
It's just that on that specific point of the family's involvement, the recommendation in the Cullen report, not implemented in the bill for financial reasons, was that the reasonable test for legal aid should be dropped in the interests of the family having better chance of securing legal representation. Could I have your view on that?
Anybody wish to take that one up?
It's not something that we had commented on in our response, but in terms of I suppose, the human rights implications, there's no explicit provision on the right to legal aid in cases of this nature within the European Convention rights, but there is an issue about equality of arms in allowing people to participate on an equal basis with other parties that do have legal representation. So there may be a case to be made to make sure that people are provided with legal representation in these types of cases.
I was just picking up on specifically what you just said about the degree in which the families were involved, mm-hmm. and making the link that perhaps if they had the legal representation, legal aid to facilitate that, that might help.
Yes, certainly that would facilitate the involvement of the next of kin. It would be a strong measure for ensuring that happens as a matter of course within FAIs.
More generally, can I ask you about delays and the recommendations to hold an early hearing, and I note what Dr. Morrison said, that by and large there isn't a huge problem, I think, with mental health cases about delays, but sometimes there can be. I may have picked you up wrongly, but could you comment on the early hearing recommendation in particular?
Yeah, if I said that delays weren't a problem in mental health, I must have been misspeaking, because certainly the few cases that where I've been involved that have proceeded to a fatal accident inquiry, the interval between the death and the inquiry seemed to have been very substantial. I listened to the earlier evidence given, and I think the main issue is whether an early hearing prejudices in any way any further action that might be taken. No.
From the evidence we had, it would be a procedural matter about right. progress being made, but substantive issues, I think when I asked Lord Cullen, will not be raised. It wouldn't be prejudicial to criminal proceedings.
Right.
Yes.
This is an early hearing is just on process to see, are we ready to go ahead? If there's a delay, what's causing the delay? It's something, I think, to really pin down the Crown and Procurator Fiscal Service and to make them accountable, and not just an early hearing to say another date if it hasn't been possible to establish why there is a delay. So it's always kept in view.
Well, I would have thought from the point of view of families that would be helpful, that they know that something is happening and they have a rough idea of what the timescale for the something is. And as you say, if it helps to prompt agencies involved to take action, that would be very helpful for the families.
I think again, there's a stage before it, the investigation stage, where HSE and the police and the Procurator Fiscal Service do talk to the families. We do explain what our role is, and we obviously have to control expectations, because we can't see at an early stage whether or not there may be proceedings, and that's not our decision. But we can explain the investigative process, and we can explain what HSE does, and that's what we try to do. Now, I think there can be improvement to that phase. I know that's not the prime purpose of examination of the bill, but you know, HSE sees the investigation phase very much leading into to any FAI or any decision on proceedings. So you know, there's no doubt there can be improvements in liaison with the families and explaining how the process works. And where we do that, and you know, we do get praise for supporting families and they understand what's happening, we can also give them an indication of how complex the investigation is, that it will take time.
So in a way, the early hearing might facilitate that, putting it actually in the bill that has to be done within 3 months might be helpful.
Yes. What wouldn't help, I think, would be the statement of fact issue, because from an HSE evidential position in terms of criminal law, we're not investigating for fatal accident purposes. We're investigating for potential breaches of criminal law and safety alerts, and there's other steps about enforcement notices to prevent recurrence. So our main aim in life is really prevent the incident again by enforcing, if necessary, by enforcement notice, issue safety alerts where they can be done, and we can have safety alerts issued in agreement with the Procurator Fiscal Service to avoid prejudice. So it's possible, by careful wording, to put a safety alert out, and we can therefore influence the wider community. And that was done, for example, the Legionnaires outbreak in Edinburgh, where we did put safety alert out about our research on what causes outbreaks of Legionnaires, and that was agreed with the Procurator Fiscal Service to avoid prejudice to potential proceedings in the future. So again, we see really the whole process from investigation phase through, and good communication at the start of that of the investigation phase, I think, would help families.
Well, nobody else is indicating. Okay. I can't poke them with a stick from
all
here.
Right.
I make you answer. I've got somebody. Is this a supplementary?
No, it's a different issue.
Different issue. You're on my list there. John, it's a supplementary.
Thanks. Yes, Mr. McNabb, that was interesting, the range of powers you have at the moment. And could you expand again, or Clara, maybe it's just myself that didn't pick up, on the issuing the safety notice without prejudice? Is there something that, perhaps if it was more compelling than just simply a warning, how can you do that without prejudice?
Well, that's what I'm saying. If we believe that we're going to be reporting to Procurator Fiscal, this depends on the stage of the investigation. But if we think it's important enough that a safety alert would need to be issued, I'm thinking about, for example, an example might be a child gets killed in electric gates in Birmingham or the Midlands. Mm-hmm. HSE in England and Wales would put out a safety alert. Well, we would want to do the same if it was a Scottish investigation, but what we would be doing is talking to the Procurator Fiscal Service as early as possible to say, well, we think this is necessary. And certainly my discussions with the Procurator Fiscal Service, they would not wish to constrain a safety alert the HSE believes is important, and we'd look to try and negotiate a form of words that avoids particular prejudice against a particular duty holder or employer, but makes the generality open to the public. Now, that is done reasonably regularly. We don't have to issue safety alerts for every workplace death investigation. It's only where there's new information coming out on a new topic, perhaps, where we want to get the word out as quickly as possible. So that can be done. The same with enforcement notices. You know, we issue enforcement notices once the appeal 21 days period is up, the notice goes on to the HSE public database. So, you know, these things can be done without prejudice to future court proceedings, and we're well versed in how to do that. And it's all about clear dialogue with COPFS and the police. We have tripartite investigations for work-related deaths. There's a work-related death protocol for Scotland, as there is for England and Wales. And, you know, that's all about tripartite strategic decision-making. It's about the police looking at potential corporate manslaughter, Corporate Homicide Act breaches, alongside HSE looking at potential Health and Safety at Work Act breaches. So the situation in the investigation phase can go a number of different directions, but we are very conscious to avoid potential prejudice to proceedings.
And can I ask in relation, I mean, the nature of your organisation is one where it's proactivity, it's prevention rather than cure that you'd be seeking.
Yes.
And, you know, a political philosophy suggests that, in fact, talked about slaying the health and safety monster, if you know that was, well, you will know that was said. Do you have sufficient resources to be proactive, even in relation to in the event of a death? And can you say what liaison you have with trade unions and staff associations who have a statutory duty to inspect the workplace, and they will presumably have records in many instances that would facilitate your investigation?
Well, it's difficult to answer on resources. I mean, how much is enough for any organisation to have? We have sufficient resources for the number of workplace deaths that I've said. That's a top reactive priority for us, is to do thorough investigations. So that will always be resourced. We're still managing to run a proactive inspection process. So, Scottish workplaces do get proactive inspections to try and prevent incidents happening. And we target, based on statistical evidence and local knowledge about which are the places and sectors that would be best to look at, for example, the waste sector or construction.
Stress, I'm not being critical of your work, being supportive of your work.
Yes, like, absolutely.
Facilitate you having more resources.
That's very helpful, thank you.
Anymore for health and safety, we're told here, so it seems a bit bizarre.
Yeah, that's one of these myths that we try not to pin on HSE.
Not helpful.
Can I return to something? Do you carry out investigations into all workplace fatalities?
Well, if it's not natural causes fatalities, it would be initial inquiries only. I mean, quite often we get out of hours calls, I'll get calls where it's not certain whether it may be natural causes as opposed to a work-related death. So initial inquiries with the police would establish that. But yes, anything that's a reportable death at work would come to HSE or local authorities, because, as you know, local authorities are co-regulators for warehousing and leisure-type activities, whereas we do the more factory end of the market. So the answer is yes, but it goes beyond what you might think of as, you know, factory-type accidents into issues of, you know, mental health, suicides in prison, suicides in healthcare. The Health and Safety Work Act is a very broad piece of legislation, as you know, and so we get brought in by the Procurator Fiscal into many issues that are not directly reportable to us. A road-related death, for example, I know has been of interest, and there's been some submissions on that. HSE, the main role in work in road-related death would be police-led, of course, under road traffic legislation. But the police do involve us from time to time, where there may be management systems behind, you know, hours of work or allegations about driver practices, employer practices, then HSE can be brought in, and we have been brought in. Usually the phrase cause and permit allows the police to look at management systems and employer duties as part of road traffic legislation, but there are occasions where HSE's Health and Safety at Work Act would be more appropriate to look at. And we have discussions with the police about when they should let us know, and similarly with the Procurator Fiscal Service. So it's a very wide range of issues. There are many fatalities where, as I said earlier, the Crown Office alerts HSE to see if we would have an interest. And that's the kind of relationship we have. It's very proactive.
It's very helpful to see how broad it is. John?
A further point, if I may, Mr McNabbin, it's from your evidence in response to the question of fixed timetables. You say that the question of delay in investigation is real and should be minimised wherever possible. However, the HSE believes that it is possible to achieve this without resorting to the inflexibility of fixed timetable. Can you say how you think it can be improved?
Yes, I've mentioned the work-related death protocol for Scotland. I mean, we've been working together with the police and Procurator Fiscal Service, and really well before the Health and Safety Division of the Fiscals was set up. But since that came into being, we've all made a concerted effort to try and speed up the investigation process. Now, it's not, you know, I'm not going to claim that there aren't some that do drag on too long, but the vast majority, it's a priority for HSE to do as thorough and as quick an investigation as possible, because we do recognise that, you know, the family's needs in these situations, and indeed the employer's needs, and indeed the need, as I've mentioned, to tell the wider world what lessons need to be learned. But the situation is that we, in discussions with having 5 years of experience of this tripartite working, police and HSE, COPFS, then we're looking at ways of, well, what have we learnt in those 5 years? How could we improve the speed of investigation? So I think we've already agreed issues with Police Scotland and with COPFS about how that could be done. The complexity comes in the interaction between the corporate manslaughter and corporate homicide legislation and health and safety legislation. The thoroughness that's required to examine larger corporations with complex structures to look to see whether corporate homicide is or is not a possibility, that takes some degree of investigation. It's not going to be a short investigation. And that's a police-led, police primacy is the term we would use, but we're in partnership with the police and the Procurator Fiscal. So it's all about that strategic decision-making. If that's done properly at week one, day one, week one, month one, direction of travel of the investigation is known by all the parties to that investigation, and we can then talk about the resourcing that's needed for the investigation to make sure that the reasonable pace is kept up. So that's the investigation phase, and I think we've put steps in place to try and improve that where possible. HSE does set itself in-house expectations about speed. And in Scotland, we've always had a good track record because of the need to put interim reports to the Procurator Fiscal to tell them the direction of travel that we think the investigation is going. Then we are quite comfortable with having some timescale expectation on us. And part of my job as head of operations is to make sure I've got enough resource, inspector resource, so we might double up or treble up or put extra specialist resource on certain investigations to try and keep them moving. But I do accept occasionally some run far too long. And these are the ones we're trying to look at. Well, what is it that's causing the delays? It may sometimes be, and this is obviously, I realise Police Scotland will be giving evidence, you know, but there's resourcing issues for both Police Scotland and for HSE. But like us, Police Scotland put a lot of resource into work-related death investigation, and rightly so.
And just, can you clarify, would the HSE make a recommendation to the Crown Office Procurator Fiscal Service that a corporation should be the subject of a prosecution?
Yes.
Thank you.
That's regularly done. And it would be a practice where there's evidential sufficiency, and in our view it's in the public interest, we would report on that basis to the Procurator Fiscal Service, and that happens every year to quite a number of cases.
And would that be two separate reports to COPFS?
No, it would normally be, if we do an interim, we'd have meetings with COPFS and the police and obviously give it verbal intimation of what we think the direction of travel, and sometimes it's very obvious to us there's a alleged breach of law.
And is that shared with the family, are you able to say, Mr McNair?
No, that wouldn't be shared with the family because that's our opinion. We would report objectively to Crown Office, yeah. Procurator Fiscal Service, as would the police. And on that basis, the Crown Office would then report to Crown Council, and Crown Council would decide whether or not it's prosecution territory or whether it's an FEI.
Okay, thank you very much.
Very helpful, thank you. Alison, followed by Rod.
To turn to a related issue, on our earlier discussion about deaths during mental health detentions, are there also human rights considerations in relation to the investigation of deaths of those subject to, say, for example, compulsory treatment orders within the community, but where the liberty might be quite significantly curtailed, or under welfare guardianship?
Yes, I think it's quite a difficult question to get the right balance. The coverage of the Article 2 requirements is essentially strongest in relation to people who are in the custody of the state. Some people who are on community orders may simply have a requirement to take medication but might be living in their own home. They probably wouldn't be considered in the custody of the state. But other people under community orders and also under welfare guardianships might be required to live somewhere against their will. So they are essentially detained in a place that they don't wish to be. And I think in some of those circumstances, those people might be considered in the custody of the state. So it's difficult to strike the right balance. It probably wouldn't be everyone that's subject to an order of that nature, but some of those people may still require the same protections as those detained in hospital.
Okay. And do you want to comment from a welfare commission point of view?
Yeah, I mean, of the 78 people I mentioned who died whilst being detained, over 30 of them were in the community. So out of the number of people who detain each year, the issue you raise is clearly significant. And I would, to answer part of the question, just echo what Cathy has said. There'll be some people that are on a CCTO who are living essentially a normal life, except that they have to go once a month and get medication. And so it'd be very hard to say that their liberty is being restricted or they're being deprived of the liberty by the state. Then, as Cathy says, there'll be other people on community orders who have to stay in a certain, possibly supported accommodation, who can't freely go out without staff with them. And then you could say, well, yeah, they are getting nearer to the state depriving of the liberty. The issue you raised about welfare guardianships is the one that's potentially scariest, if that's a technical word that I can use in front of such a committee. But there are close to 10,000 people in welfare guardianships in Scotland at the moment. Probably about 40% of them are older people with dementia. Their liberty will be being restricted because most of them will be in care homes where they can't freely go out. Because of their age and their frailty, they're highly likely to die over any period. So if we were thinking that this large number of people also required fatal accident inquiries, we would be introducing something that was probably entirely unworkable into the system, as well as, I say, distressing lots of families whose grandmother with dementia has simply got pneumonia and died, as older people do.
I wonder if you think there's a subset of that group then that might need some further analysis or looking at. I mean, I know that many families feel that there's have concerns about the overuse of medication, for example, in such circumstances in care homes. Whether there are any circumstances that you think we should be looking for FEIs?
Off the top of my head, no. Okay. Because I think it would be hard to sift out in that population which issues were of most concern. I mean, I suppose in a preventative way, the Scottish Government's been doing really good work as part of the dementia strategy for the past few years to deal with people with dementia who have stressed and distressed behaviours without resorting to medication. So hopefully that would prevent that kind of situation. I suppose in that situation, we would be relying on the discretionary kind of role of the Procurator Fiscal and the Lord Advocate, where somebody felt that circumstances were out of the ordinary, mm-hmm. to raise it directly with them.
Okay, thank you. Probably also a role for the Care Commission.
Yeah.
Alerted if there's something that seemed to be happening within a particular care home. Yeah. Rod.
Mr. McNabb, I'd just like to turn, if I may, to kind of your views on...
I think it's a care inspectorate now, is it?
It is, yeah.
It's not the Care Commission, that's old hat. Yes, sorry about that, Rod.
Yeah,
care inspectorate.
To turn to the question war, of the status of sheriff's recommendations at the end of a fatal accident inquiry. Perhaps you could give us your views on kind of
yes.
that.
Our view is that we would not support mandatory because the experience is that inquiries, important as they are, but they don't always cover all of the issues, nor do they always call all the right witnesses to, you know, so that the sheriff could be left in a position where putting mandatory decisions on regulators like HSE or other parties, when actually there may be more of an issue, there may be other risks emerge which have not been debated at the FEI. Now, that would be where, obviously, if HSE was giving evidence, we would try and give our view to prevent that happening. But at the end of the day, the best example I have, and I know it's dangerous to use one example and say, well, therefore that proves the case, but the Rose Park care home fire, for example, where HSE, I submitted pages of written evidence, but for various reasons, HSE was not called to give oral evidence. So our evidence was never tested in the public domain. The sheriff's determination, which I would say HSE has always tried to act on sheriff's determination, we see them as important. We always have done. We would always do our utmost to comply and to promulgate information to other government departments if that's relevant. But in that situation, the sheriff put a recommendation on that actually neither ourselves, the Fire and Rescue Service, the Scottish Government, we had meetings of all these parties to try and do what the sheriff wanted, but couldn't actually do exactly what the sheriff recommended. Now, that was never explored at the FAI and gave HSE quite a few problems, because the assumption was that HSE in future would inspect electrics in cupboards in care homes. But actually, it's not a priority area for us to inspect. Statistically, one major incident, terrible as it is, does not necessarily mean that we need to be inspecting every single care home. So that was never explored. So, that's the issue for me, is really about just very pragmatically why we would prefer that it's left as a strong steer. The example that was quoted about the family that was killed by the crane, HSE was involved in that. We had legal representation, the reason being because it was a complex interaction between road traffic legislation and Health and Safety at Work Act. HSE did take forward the sheriff's recommendations, even though we were not the main authority, because the main authority was the Department of Transport, who did not give evidence. We took forward the sheriff's view that these cranes should have MOTs. And we actually took it upon ourselves to go beyond what the FAI and sheriff had said, and we actually approached DOT directly ourselves. We also approached the Mobile Crane Association. So we did everything we possibly could do, but it was not within our gift to make it happen. As I understand it, actually, I believe MOTs for these cranes, road-going cranes, is being looked at in the UK, but there's a cost to the facilities to actually test them. So there's a whole lot of issues that were not explored at the FAI in that crane incident, which would make it impossible to meet a mandatory direction. Whereas it's very possible for HSE to do something as things stand at the moment, or with the proposal that's being put forward, to give a strong steer and to ask parties like HSE to respond back to the court as to what have we done. And if we can't do something, we would be more than happy to give an explanation of why there are constraints and what we can achieve.
Thank you.
That's interesting. So, so what you're saying is if the recommendation is not mandatory, there could be a further hearing, am I understanding it, with the sheriff regarding difficulties?
Well, I think what's proposed, you know, under one scenario would be that sheriff makes a recommendation,
yes.
The relevant parties, and I'm taking HSE being a relevant party,
yes.
HSE would do its utmost to comply, would respond back to the sheriff as to what we're doing and why. If, however, we couldn't quite agree that there may be other risks created, we would point these risks out. There may be a reason why HSE is not the right relevant authority,
right.
Because we might not have the vire as the legal responsibility to take all of the recommendation forward. That would then be our response back. So it'd be a public explanation of what we have done, and if we can't do it all, why not? And we would be very comfortable with that, because that's pretty much what we do anyway. It's just that it's not fully in the public domain.
It's not part of process at the moment. Patricia.
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Ms. McNabb.
Good morning.
I take your point, but the sheriff presumably would make recommendations to whomsoever he thought it was appropriate to make those recommendations to, not necessarily to HSE, and he would surely make a judgment as to who the appropriate authority was.
Yes, I accept that, yes.
Yeah. I'm thinking about the example you gave of Rose Park, and I understand the difficulties that may have occurred there. However, I'm also thinking in connection with the crane incident that yourself and Mr. Tasker earlier mentioned, and Mr. Tasker did say that the sheriff had written to the UK government to ensure that MOT, or to try to ensure that MOTs for such vehicles did become the norm or the requirement, and you've told us that that is actually going to happen. So that would suggest to me that that is a recommendation made by a sheriff that actually perhaps couldn't have been binding, but was a good one for that sheriff to make.
But yes, I accept that, but in that case, I would submit it would have been better had the Department of Transport been at the FAI to lead evidence. The point is the HSE... Yeah. It's not the relevant regulatory authority for road-going cranes and the safety of the road-going equipment. We have a responsibility on the crane lifting equipment rather than the crane itself. So that's really my point, is that the relevant people that have the expertise would have to be giving evidence to FAI for the right decision to be made in the sheriff's determination.
I don't think that's necessarily an argument against the sheriff having the option of making a recommendation where they think fit, however. And I would, you know, you've said you raised Rose Park as an example, and perhaps using one example is not always helpful. But, you know, if you look at the Belgrove and Newton train crashes, for example, they happened years apart. Recommendations were made by a sheriff of suggestions that could have prevented another such accident happening. And 4 years later, I believe, exactly the same issue arose again because the sheriff's recommendations had not been put forward and had not been taken account of by those responsible. So those are the kinds of recommendations that I think the committee is trying to consider, whether it is appropriate for a sheriff to look at those cases.
Yes, I mean, I certainly can see the argument, but as I say, for HSE's position is that we believe we can achieve the same outcome, because at the end of the day, those issues that fall to HSE as a regulator, we have always tried to promulgate professionally. We don't ignore determinations in any way. All I'm saying is HSE is not always. We're talking about complex overlaps of legislation that don't always lend themselves to fully being explored at an FAI, and that's just a fact.
But I was just trying to establish, Convener, that we're not actually talking about HSE necessarily. We're talking about the sheriff making recommendations to whichever body is appropriate.
I appreciate that. I think it's whether or not, if it's mandatory, it's practicable, enforceable and appropriate.
Indeed.
From what you're saying from that previous one. Would Section 10, 1, subsection, subsection E... This just allows the sheriff to call any other person who the sheriff is satisfied has an interest in the inquiry. Does that happen just now? Can a sheriff say, I think I should have HSE in front of me, or whatever, the trade union?
Well, for HSE, it's slightly different, because we are, as you'll see, and the current bill just repeats, it takes on the power for HSE to be be a witness anyway, so we've always had that ability. Yeah. So a work-related death that falls within HSE's jurisdiction, we would automatically be a witness.
But in the case you're talking about, you weren't, and neither were transport.
That was an unusual one, which is why I said I didn't want to try and quote one case as proving everything else. Yes. That was unusual. We did give written evidence, as I said, but not oral evidence.
And
I would say in most cases, HSE inspectors or specialist inspectors give evidence to work-related death inquiries, FAIs. So you know, we are represented, and part of my job is to look at the wider tactics. So if I think, and this is why I mentioned that we, for certain ones, we would have legal representation because we think we need to explore some policy areas that would actually help the inquiry.
Yeah.
And in which case that seems to work pretty well, and the determinations do explore the territory we think you know, would be beneficial in the public interest.
Well, I want to thank you all for your evidence. It's very, very interesting, and a very interesting area for us to explore. Could I then suspend for a minute just to allow witnesses to thank you very much to change over and move on to the final panel of witnesses. We're only... I welcome the third and final panel of witnesses to the meeting. I welcome Ian Miller, Executive Legal Manager at Glasgow City Council, and DCS Robbie Allen of Police Scotland. Can I thank you for your written submissions? And I'll go straight to questions, please. I'm looking to my left this time to let you all come in earlier if you wish, but you're not responding. So, Elaine and Margaret, the faithful two.
Elaine. I wanted to ask witnesses, first of all, about the issues regarding deaths during detention under mental health legislation, or indeed of children compulsory living away from home, for whom particularly Glasgow City Council local authorities will be responsible for some children who are not resident at home. I wondered if you could maybe outline what the current arrangements would be and whether these are sufficiently independent.
Mr. Miller.
Yes, thank you. Certainly, the Glasgow City Council is supportive of the proposal in the bill to have a mandatory inquiry for any child who dies in secure accommodation, and that the local authority may well be involved with such a child being looked after in terms of the relevant legislation. There are other regulations, namely the Looked After Scotland regulations of 2009, where there is a compulsory measure whereby if a child who is looked after by the local authority, so we're not just talking about children who are in secure accommodation, but basically any child who is in the care, currently in the care of the local authority, then if that child dies, then the local authority must notify the Scottish ministers and the care inspectorate. That must happen within one day of the death, and within 28 days there must be a further fuller report submitted to the care inspectorate. Now, one of the things that would certainly happen within the local authority setting, irrespective of that, is that there would be undoubtedly a significant case review looking at all the circumstances. Currently, we are well aware that there could be in these circumstances, it would be a discretionary fatal accident inquiry. So, very early on in these circumstances, the local authority would be well aware of the real possibility, even although it's one of the circumstances where there's a discretionary FAI, of a fatal accident inquiry. So, overall, the council has responded that they think that the current measures are sufficient.
There's no argument for making it, as Lord Cullen himself would have recommended that it should be mandatory in those circumstances.
I hesitate to refer to resources, but one wonders in how many circumstances there would be mandatory fatal accident inquiries. Also, what would they achieve? What I would argue is that in terms of certainly the Looked After Children Scotland regulations and the reporting mechanisms the early reports in internal investigations which have to be made, that there is an early investigation of all the facts, and there could well be further scrutiny at the instance of the Lord Advocate in terms of a discretionary fatal accident inquiry. So, certainly, in our experience, and certainly having canvassed widely within the authority, within those who are principally our social work department and those who are involved in social care, we would not see it as currently a requirement to be a mandatory situation.
Do you think they're sufficiently independent if it's an in-house inquiry?
Well,
I don't mean to be, you know, scathing. That's not the meaning, but it is in-house. And do you feel that that's enough independence?
Well, there wouldn't just be that. There is this report in terms of the 2009 regulations to not only notification within one day to the Scottish ministers and the care inspectorate, and a further... within a further 28 days, there is a much fuller report to the care inspectorate, and the care inspectorate would review that matter in terms of seeking medical information, looking from an education point of view. Would also separately liaise with the Crown Office and Procurator Fiscal Service. So, from that point of view, I think there's. You know, there's certainly safeguards. We're not just talking about an internal inquiry.
Alison, I think you wanted to ask that. Do you want to go on and ask more about that?
That's fine.
You sure?
Fine. Yeah.
Do you want to come in as I trample on you a bit there by mistake?
Perhaps later on.
Thank you. Margaret?
Yes, so we're into the afternoon. Good afternoon, gentlemen. I wonder if you could comment in terms of delays, the Cullen Review recommended... and Police Scotland will obviously be involved in initial investigations, the establishment of a specialist unit within COPFS to ensure that the unit was and COPFS were properly resourced, and hence by connection ensuring that there was no delay because of a lack of resource. Could you comment on that specifically, DCSL?
Yeah, I'm quite comfortable with the current arrangements in relation to the death units that are set up within COPFS. Obviously, we investigate the full variety of deaths, from criminality, corporate, accidental, engage with HSE as well, and there are specific units already established within Crown that we go to in relation to each of those types of deaths, depending on what it is. I don't think that the lack of another specialist unit is causing any delay, from my personal opinion. I believe that what's in place is sufficient at this time.
Thank you.
suppose it was a resourcing question, and I note that Police Scotland had raised some concerns that if we look at deaths abroad, then there would be an investigation element and therefore a resourcing element connected with that.
Yeah, I think that was where we were basically just trying to kind of wrestle with what that looked like, the deaths abroad, what that exercise looked like when it was applied within COPFS and Police Scotland. Was it very much a paper exercise where we were taking information from abroad and reviewing that? Was it more proactive than that? What did that level of intrusion require to be? Obviously it's not something we do at the moment, so there would obviously be additional resource required to undertake that, depending what level of scrutiny was going to be applied.
I'm going off the resource issue now onto this question of an early hearing as opposed to a preliminary hearing where it's procedural, held within 3 months, and really just it's, an assessment of where we are. If there are going to be any delays, explanations why that there are going to be delays, and a way of keeping the family informed and keeping the Crown and Procurator of Fiscal, and I suppose by extension the police and anyone else involved in it, very much on their toes.
Absolutely, fully supportive of that, having been involved as a senior investigating officer on a number of these types of inquiries. Obviously, we will undertake a considerable amount of inquiry in that first 3 months. There's no doubt that that's when a great deal of the work is done. And I think it's only right that based on that initial work that's done, that also gives us a clear idea of as to the direction of travel going forward, whether there's to be corporate issues, whether there's to be it's going to remain within an HSE environment. I think that 3 month kind of timeline is good, and it's one that I think a significant amount of information can be handed over without going into the specifics of the actual case and evidence and things like that. And I think it does give a great deal of transparency to the families, to the interested parties, as to the kind of timescale that we're working to. Obviously, every inquiry is different, and there will be some that are much further ahead at 3 months than others. Having been involved in somewhere, you get to a certain stage and you need to stop because you're awaiting other people. But even if that was made obvious at that time, I'm involved in quite a high-profile one just now where I can't do anything at this time until I get a report from an outside agency. I think even if that was out in the public domain, that's what stopped the police inquiry at this time, that would be very helpful to everybody.
Yeah. No other views? I don't
think so. Okay. Mentioning on that, no.
No particular comments on the early hearing.
Rod?
DCS Allen, is there any information that you can share with the committee on kind of current practice in the triangle between yourselves and the Crown Office and kind of the family of victims of people who might otherwise be looking for a fatal accident inquiry? How does that work in terms of communication?
At the moment, the process will be, obviously, the police will deploy to every death. And normally, when it's a death of unexplained and either a suspicious type of death, we will deploy family liaison officers. So that initial engagement with the family is there. And we certainly will keep the family updated during that initial aspect of the police inquiry. And they'll know what we're doing, particularly around about how we are managing that initial investigative strategy, the scene, etc. Where it then moves on to is once we've done that initial piece of investigation and we ultimately will report the circumstances to COPFS, I think that's probably where we need to tighten up a fair bit in relation to, we're not that we back away, but we've done the work that's expected of us. We've reported into Crown. There then is an onus on Crown at that stage, I believe, to maintain that engagement with the family because it's basically into the judicial process then. So I think that's the bit that probably needs to be tightened up a bit in relation to that longer piece or that longer time when it's going through the due process.
Is there anything in the bill that you would like to see in that respect to improve matters?
I think we go back to the earlier question about additional resources. I think there is mechanisms in place by which Crown and police engage with families. Probably we find that is a difficult thing to do, just resources and the timescales involved in it. So having a sufficiency of resources to do that would be absolutely paramount.
Okay. Thank you.
Christian?
Yes, going back to the death occurring abroad, and I was looking in the contents of the bill, in sections 6 and 7, I don't see any details there about what you would be expected to do. And is that your worry? Would you like the bill to be more precise of what kind of engagement you should have with all your jurisdiction, and if there are travels, if there are languages, if there are other things to do? Would you want it maybe to specify that you wouldn't want to duplicate work which has been done abroad?
Yeah, I think that probably does need to be made clear, because when our initial reading of it wasn't clear. My first question is, does that mean that we need to deploy Police Scotland officers into a foreign country? If that's not what's intended from the bill, and it is an exercise of that we engage through Foreign and Commonwealth Office, get information from that country, review it, assess it, ascertain what we're doing, then that's fine. But if there are huge logistical issues, if we've to start to deploy officers abroad, so I think we would probably look for just some clarity around about that's not what's intended here and exactly what it is that we're expected to do.
Thanks, that would be it.
Yes, Jane.
DCS Alan, when matters are drawn to a conclusion and an investigation comes to an end into a death, what systems are in place to communicate or liaise or discuss with families, especially if they're not happy about the outcome of the investigation? And would that include giving them information or letting them see evidence? How is all that drawn to a close?
Again, that would be down to COPFS. Ultimately, we will report to COPFS in relation to all deaths. Now, what I would say from Police Scotland's point of view, no matter what that death is we deploy to, we would go on the assumption that at some stage the circumstances of that death will be tested within some form of judicial process, whether that's an FAI, whether it's a court case. So we will undertake the investigation to that level. There are ones, and we will then report every death to COPFS. If there is absolutely nothing suspicious, it's very much as a result of natural causes, that will be communicated to the family. If the circumstances are such that there is something more complicated about it and there's more explanation requires to go to the family, to me that would be very much down to COPFS, because it's they who would make that decision as to how you move forward from that police investigation.
Okay, thanks. Thank you.
Well, that's, thankfully for you, it was brief, although you've had to wait a while for it. But thank you very much for your evidence. That concludes this session. And I'll suspend for a minute just to allow the witnesses to gather their papers. Thank you. Item 4, members content to delegate authority for me to consider and approve any witness expenses claims in relation to the inquiries into fatal acts and sudden death Scotland Bill as is usual practice. Thank you very much. I formally close the meeting. However.